This presentation, this slide deck, is actually much shorter than one that I have that goes into many, many more details on using StatEye with DDR5 and LPDDR5. So I do intend to make that available sometime after DesignCon and record a much longer presentation for you with many, many more details. Also, I noticed Khaled had a really good presentation out in the hallway on some of the clocking that's also I mentioned in this presentation. So, all right, let's get started. So anyone who started working with DDR5 and LPDDR5 knows that these technologies have equalization, specifically in the RX side for the DRAM. And this is to improve signal integrity issues in the DDR channels. So IBC MI models, you've probably worked with those in SerDes. They allow simulation of these equalization effects that we can have in TX and RX buffers. But we have to use very different simulation techniques from the transient analysis we may be used to doing with technologies like DDR4. The tool PrimeSim HSPICE StatEye is a tool that you can use to simulate our DDR IBIS AMI models. And it's a very comprehensive tool, lots and lots of features, lots and lots of settings, and it has these advanced capabilities. You can simulate all the channel nonlinearities you may have in a DDR system. You can use lots of different types of transmitter and receiver models together in simulation. You can do the simulation of millions of bits that you need, extrapolation of jitter to get down to very low bit error rates that you need for DDR5. A lot of capabilities that you simply can't do with transient analysis. So I'll be talking about some of the features in StatEye and specifically some interesting things with the StatEye Tran mode and also the very new clocked IBIS AMI models that are featured in IBIS 7.1. So get into those coming up. So if you've ever worked with StatEye for a SerDes simulation, you have to set things up just a little bit differently to simulate a DDR channel. And that's because you may be working with more nonlinear models, and StatEye allows you to combine some different model types together you might not do for a SerDes simulation. This diagram here shows you've got options for a transmitter and receiver where you can kind of mix and match models. You can use just a simple linear model on your transmitter side. You can do that if you have some equalization to model like an FFE. But if you don't, you can use a traditional IBIS model. So you can have all of the nonlinear characteristics of your transmitter within that IBIS model. You could also have a SPICE model for your transmitter. And when you do that, then you also use a different type of stimulus that the port element is an input to the B element as opposed to a stimulus within the port element itself. On the receiver side also, you can use an IBIS or SPICE model representing all those analog characteristics. And then you attach a port element for your receiver IBIS AMI model that's going to have the equalization characteristics in it. Talk a little bit more about the stimulus. So the stimulus there is where you can define a pattern source and LFSR to have a random, pseudo-random bit sequence. You have to remember if this is an input to a B element to be sure that you're using the proper voltage levels, 0 and 1, versus like in SerDes, you may have had -1, +1. So you need to change those voltage levels. And remember, it's supposed to look like a digital signal. So you want that to have very fast rising and falling times. Also to note is if you want a truly random bit pattern like you'd have in a statistical analysis, then you don't define a pattern or an LFSR source at all. Also on your port element stimulus is where you can add jitter, your deterministic or random jitter. Now, if you have an IBIS AMI model, you're gonna have some reserved parameters describing that jitter. And the important thing to note is if you're taking those parameters out of the AMI file and putting them into this stimulus port element, there's a bit of conversion that you need to do between how those parameters are given in the AMI file versus how you use them in the HSPICE syntax. So you can look at the slide later for details on that. Now, over on the receiver side, you're gonna, again, combine an IBIS buffer to get those analog characteristics of your die capacitance, your ODT characteristics. And then in parallel, instantiating with the port element, your IBIS AMI model. So just some things to note there is that your port element for that AMI model, you need to ensure that you set a high impedance there because you don't want a 50 ohm impedance on the port that's in parallel with the termination that you have in your B element. Also, some other interesting settings I'll talk about relate to DC offset, and I'll talk about those in the next slide. So DC offset in IBIS refers to the DC common mode voltage that you have in a DR system. So part of the processing that you're doing in the IBIS AMI flow is doing a step response and converting that to an impulse response. When you do that, you lose the DC common mode voltage, but that's important. The DC offset is something the simulator will calculate and then can be passed into the RX model, and that AMI model can use that to model effects such as gain saturation. And then also, the EDA tool can take that DC offset. Again, it has to remove it from any waveform that's being processed in AMI through the getWave function. But at the end, it can add that DC offset back into the waveform purely for display purposes. So if you look at an unequalized die versus an equalized die, they'll be at the same voltage levels, just for convenience. So kind of a new feature in StatEye recently was added, which is the stat mode. And this is just helpful to make sure that that when you want to do a statistical simulation versus a bit-by-bit simulation, it helps you enable that statistical mode in StatEye. And so it does something useful. I mentioned how if you wanted to do a statistical analysis, your port element, you don't want to define a pattern or some pseudo-random bit stream. And if you didn't have the stat mode option, you'd have to have two netlists, one for working in bit-by-bit mode and one for working in statistical mode. But if you enable this stat mode, and it simply ignores all of the patterns that you may have defined for working in bit-by-bit mode, so you can use one netlist for doing both types of simulations. Another thing of interest with stat mode is that you can actually do filtering either in init or getWave functions. And you can run into some issues if the tool is doing filtering in getWave and you also have a DFE that requires some sort of training. So if you see like an ignore bits related in your RX related to the time it takes to do DFE or CDR training, then that can cause issues with the statistical mode. So you can take some little shortcuts to force the parameter, the AMI reserved parameter, to a setting that ensures that StatEye will only do processing within it. The mode you're gonna use a lot is edge mode. This is kind of multi-edge response, superposition. This has been part of StatEye for a very long time. And this is really what's important to use for DDR simulation, because we have rising and falling edge mismatches in our transmitter, other nonlinearities, and these edge modes are gonna capture a lot of that nonlinearity that you have. You have a few different options. You can set the edge mode to be, you know, 1, 2, 4, or 8. If you set it to 1, that's kind of the traditional flow where you take a single edge and convert that to an impulse response. If you do that, you don't capture the differences between rising edges and falling edges, so you need to select at least an edge mode of 2. And if you go to an edge mode of 4 or 8, use more patterns, you're gonna capture more nonlinearities. Your simulation time is gonna increase because these are all characterizations that, you know, transient simulations that have to be done at the start before the IBIS AMI processing really starts. So Remember, there's a trade-off of simulation time to accuracy here. Some cool things you can do in Tran mode. Tran mode can be a very, very accurate but very slow way to do AMI processing. But if you have something like a waveform that you have from measurement or from another transient simulation or another EDA tool, and really you just want to take that waveform and pass it through a receiver AMI model, you know, apply the DFE, see what happens, Tran mode can be very useful for that. And so requires attention to detail. There's a lot of things that can go wrong there, but you have a couple of different methods to take your waveform, put it in either with some of these stream arguments or as a PWL file. And you can, if you need a bunch of ignore bits in your model to do some of the training in your receiver to kind of get it all set up before doing AMI processing, you can, you know, repeat that waveform over and over and actually very easily then use it in training and then leave a part at the end that you're processing for the AMI piece. Kind of going to run a little short on time, so I won't get into too many details. There are some issues with using Tran mode, as I mentioned. One of those is having that DC common mode voltage in your waveform. Remember, you have to make sure that that's not part of the waveform you're passing into a get wave function. So you either need to remove that from the waveform, or you need to have an AMI model that can actually adjust for having a waveform that has DC common mode voltage in it. Some of the Micron models we have can adjust to that situation. And I'll save it for later. You can read the slide about some other issues with adaptation algorithms. It can be kind of unique to some of our models if you're doing this Tran mode. Another pretty recent feature in StatEye is this ability to capture steady state noise and add that voltage noise in. Previously, if you had this voltage noise in there, you'd get some incorrect results. But now StatEye, if you enable this steady state option, will actually do a steady state edge response. So if you have an edge 4, it kind of does an extra edge characterization, and it can look at that steady state response and remove that voltage noise from other edge responses, and then properly convolve that in at the end in order to get the effect of voltage noise in your eye diagram. So that's something to check out. New features in IBIS 7.1, models that can take into account clocking of data, like we have in DDR5, LP5, where we have a strobe clocking your data. We're all working on models, and the EDA tools are supporting these new features. It's important because you have this clock tree delay on the strobe, and we now need to kind of model that effect because it can have especially an effect with SJ, sinusoidal jitter, in your system. You have this multiple UI delay, and so especially jitter at higher frequencies is going to become additive within the system and no longer correlated. Show you here what that looks like. If you have jitter on your data and your strobe and you start to have this multi-UI delay, when you go to the higher frequencies of SJ, you'll see that effect in there with significantly more jitter than what you'd expect from previous generations of the memory. Quick example, just to show you an LP5 setup here with a couple of devices, and just to really show you the difference in edge mode and Tran mode. So you have the transient on the right side. StatEye Tran mode looks almost exactly the same. And between your different edge modes, you'll start to see that you'll get better and better correlation there. And then just looking post equalization with the AMI model, you can see the DFE effect in there too. So in summary, we've got a great tool here with the PrimeSim HSPICE StatEye. You can mix and match your models. You can work with everything you've got. You can get these IBIS AMI models to support the equalization modeling you need to do. And just a lot of differences from what you were doing with simulating SerDes channels in StatEye. Check out that stat mode simplification. Remember to use the 248 on edge mode. Unique things you can do with TRAN mode. And check out the clocked IBIS AMI models that will be out there for memory devices supported in StatEye. You'll be able to use those soon. So good luck with your DDR5 and LP5 designs.